Today we're talking about, wait, Congress is doing things besides impeaching the president right now? Who knew? In the background of the newspaper, maybe on the 20th page next to the obituary section, you may have read that there's a new compromise push to push through new NAFTA, or the USMCA, and get it approved by Congress. Now that might not sound newsworthy on its own, because, well, if I'm being honest, it's not the first time I've reported on this story. But things have started to get odd because of how long America has been dragging its feet on this one. This is specifically because Mexico has not only ratified and approved the treaty, but at this point they've actually started implementing the changes. Take for example November 20th, or maybe yesterday, depending on how quickly I can rally and get this episode out. It was a historic moment for Mexico because it was the first time workers were given the right to vote on a labor contract negotiated by their union under a new law. Yes, the one main thing about this new NAFTA renegotiation was a push for workers' rights in Mexico, under the idea that, well, if we can't beat them on price, we'll just have to make labor more expensive and better regulated. It turns out that Trump's quite the Latin American socialist. So if Mexico's implementing new labor reforms that the leaders from Canada, the United States, and Mexico all agree to, what's the problem?
House Speaker Nancy Pelosi says Congress is making real progress on the negotiations to pass the new USMCA trade deal with Mexico and Canada. The big sticking point that remains is enforcement. Of course, all of this is happening amid the impeachment hearings.
Yes, enforcement is the name of the game today. Democrats are giving the USMCA labor provisions themselves a thumbs up. But what's a great list of rules if nobody's following them? You're just shouting commands into the void.
We don't have the assurances that we need on enforcement. I myself voted for NAFTA. I had some disappointments, but one of the big disappointments is if you don't have enforcement, you are just having a conversation.
Glad we got that one settled. Now to the million-dollar question. How do we get that enforcement? Well, when you start asking how, the think pieces tend to dry up really quickly. I found that there are two solutions that are, well, not super sexy. According to logistics company JOC's website, yeah, I really had to go down a deep hole to find these proposals, the most obvious solution would be to change the wording of the dispute resolution mechanisms to ensure that they limit loopholes, are binding, and serve as sufficient incentive to meet NAFTA's requirements. Of course, if you decide to rewrite parts of an international treaty, well, I think Canada and Mexico might have some thoughts. Now if we go this route, it would require reopening negotiations, something Canada and Mexico have both already said, we didn't want to reopen negotiations 2 years ago. We don't want to re-reopen negotiations today. Still, ignoring that pretty huge issue, there's a large loophole that could be fixed. A loophole meant Mexico could theoretically block a dispute panel from being created. Basically, in writing the USMCA, America directly copied the enforcement mechanisms from the original NAFTA. Over the past 30 years, our lawyers abused every rule in the book with regard to avoiding enforcement, so now everybody knows where the holes are. Basically, every time two companies have a dispute, they send panelists to meet and negotiate a resolution. Sounds good. Problem is, if one country doesn't choose any panelists, well, geez, we didn't really think of that. I guess we'll just have to ignore the problem. The United States used this quite a few times to ignore complaints from Mexico about our sugar trade practices. In this new agreement, we didn't punch up the language there at all, which means, well, Mexico could just not send representatives and we would be left sitting on our hands. According to Jennifer A. Hillman, a senior fellow for trade and international political economy at the Council on Foreign Relations specializing in U.S. trade policy, the law and politics of the World Trade Organization, international organizations, and Brexit, there are two solutions here. Yeah, she sounds pretty relevant. Although, geez, how many pages is your business card? First, there's the easier one. Congress should insist that rosters of panelists from the United States, Canada, and Mexico be agreed upon pursuant to the USMCA's dispute mechanisms and presented to Congress before the implementing legislation is voted on. Now, this would make it impossible to dock these dispute resolution meetings. And, well, it would be incredibly suspicious if Mexico refused to comply. Hey, before I sign this huge trade contract, can I have a way to contact you? Nope. Okay, well, I'm sure you'll do exactly what you said you would. The other resolution to this issue is to rewrite this section of the agreement. Now, I'm not going to go into a ton of detail on this, because even I have a threshold for how boring an episode can be. But apparently the Trans-Pacific Partnership has a much better enforcement mechanism, and both Canada and Mexico have signed on to that, so we could copy that one instead. Now, America of course didn't just leave this enforcement section unpunched up because Donald Trump wholeheartedly trusts Mexico to enforce the rules we tell them to. Instead, here's our trade representative testifying before Congress.
The USMCA and NAFTA before it had a provision that said in certain circumstances a country can opt out of the panel decision if they want to. We did not change that. We left that in place largely because we didn't want to be in a position where someone could challenge U.S. trade laws.
And they said the impeachment inquiry lacked pizzazz. Yeah, remember how I said that the U.S. used this loophole to get out of a ton of enforcement meetings about sugar? Well, it's not like we're overjoyed to change that situation. Better enforcement goes both ways, and whoo boy do we not want that. We have sugar to sell here, and we can only cram so much of that into a 2 liter of Mountain Dew before you have to add some water. We have to start exporting this. So, alright, with that strategy maybe out the window because we're not the biggest fans of accountability on our end, is there another way to enforce the law against Mexico and not have them be able to challenge us back? Well, never fear, because our trade representative found a way to point at Mexico without three fingers pointing back at us. If a country decides to block a dispute panel, we have a card in our back pocket.
Our view is that we can enforce our laws in the rare circumstance where there was a blockage by using our unilateral law under 301.
So what does that mean? Well, if Section 301 sounds familiar, it's because it's how we justified most of our tariffs on other countries. Basically, he's saying, if someone blocks a request for enforcement, we're going to unilaterally apply tariffs and start a trade war. I mean, that's one way to enforce a free trade deal. Mr. Lighthizer is considering the use of tariffs under Section 301 of the Trade Act of 1974, the same legislation that's been used to impose tariffs on China origin goods, to guarantee compliance with the USMCA's labor and environmental provisions. So those are the two real options that are currently being seriously discussed. On one hand, we could go with the deal we have and not talk to any of the other countries and start a trade war, essentially killing the deal, if we ever want to enforce labor laws. On the other hand, we could either leverage Democrats' refusal to sign or rewrite and renegotiate an entire section of the agreement in order to make sure everybody, including us, is held more accountable to the agreement. We'll see what eventually shakes out there, but hey, at least we know that there's one thing that everybody in Congress can agree on. Workers' rights, union representation, and a higher minimum wage are all of the utmost importance in Mexico. It's easy to forget that our leaders are locked in a fight as to which strategy is the best to fight for the dignity of the Mexican worker right now. Mexico has recently increased their minimum wage and that voting rights union law that we talked about at the beginning. So it looks like, at least in the short term, America is helping push that country far enough left that we might be able to actually compete with them in automobiles and some of the other sectors. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I'd like to thank my patrons for helping me put out my videos. If you want to support independent nonpartisan news looking into the public policy arguments going on behind the scenes and join this growing list of exceptional individuals, link in the description. Remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head or do it the old school style by clicking subscribe. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.